morning, everybody. We really welcome you joining with us for our service this morning. A big welcome from Elim Pentecostal Church, Durham Nord in Sunderland. And we just want to invite you to join with us. Those of you that are at home, just join with us as we sing a couple of songs of worship to the Lord. And we just ask that God will really meet with you right where you are. We'll just pray briefly. Lord Jesus, we just thank you so much that you're with us this morning. Lord, we thank you that we know that wherever we are, you are there. We pray that you would connect us together wherever each person is right now, that they will not feel alone, Lord, but that they would feel that we are together in spirit, one in heart and mind. And Lord, for those who this morning have need, we just ask that you would really bless them. Just bless them, Lord, in whatever way that they need. In your mighty name, amen.
Hidden glory in creation, Mary.
in you have set us free. You have given us life. You have given us purpose. You have given us hope and joy. You have shown us the reality of love. And we thank you for your surrender, Lord Jesus. We worship you and we exalt your name. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Sue, and the rest of the worship team for leading us in worship and for opening our service this morning. That first song talked about the name of Jesus. And it referred to the name as beautiful, as wonderful, as powerful. We heard about how we all need compassion, forgiveness. And I just want to thank God and thank Jesus for the cross. That through Jesus' death, we can have new life. That we can come, if we call upon the name of Jesus, we can come and we can feel God's compassion towards us. That song also talked about the power that is in the name of Jesus. And indeed, the name of Jesus can move mountains. God is that powerful. So I just want to encourage you this morning that whatever situation you're in, whatever mountain you are facing, just bring it to God. Bring it to God in prayer, because he has the power to move mountains. I must ask for your forgiveness of you to be gracious towards me, because I confess there are times I forget to send the Zoom link out for prayer meeting. I just want to encourage everybody that the password and the ID for our 8 o'clock Saturday morning prayer meetings are the same each week. I will send out that Zoom link this week, but if you hold on to it, that'll then carry on week after week. We can't underestimate the power of prayer. So I hope to see you on Saturday morning. We're going to carry on with our service. We've got Tracy leading our children's church this morning. And then we have a faith story. And then we have a message that's from John and Debbie Bullock through at Newcastle. And they've done a series with their church. And they've shared that first session with us this morning. And I think as we listen to that later on, I really think there's something there that will resonate with us. I'm a firm believer that, you know, God speaks. God speaks through his word. God speaks to us through situations. God uses other people to speak. And he gives us more than one chance. And the topic that is talked about this morning is something that as a church, we've actually looked at quite a bit. But I think God obviously wants us to get the message. So we'll look forward to that. I want to thank the Lord for his faithful provision. And just to remind those who are regular attenders and members that for your tithes and offerings, our financial details are available on the website. Or if you get in touch with us, if you need any further help with that. For those who are in the building this morning, there are collection baskets at both of the exits. Thank you for your faithful giving. The work of the Lord requires funding, and we do really appreciate your faithfulness in giving. So let's carry on with our service and children's church.
Good morning. Welcome to Children's Church. I hope you've had a very blessed week this week. Well, today we're going to look further into Acts. If you remember, the last few weeks we've been looking about Jesus sending the gift of the Holy Spirit and Peter and the other followers being blessed and going into the streets and sharing the good news about Jesus and performing many miracles in Jesus' name. And obviously the other Jewish leaders were not happy about this. And they started to persecute the followers of Jesus. And that included the stoning of Stephen. Well, Saul was one of the people who was in charge and oversaw the other people stoning Stephen. And then Saul saw it as his personal role to actually get rid of these followers and have them arrested and thrown into prison. And because of that, he was very thorough. They were going from house to house and throwing their followers into prison. The people scattered and went to other towns. And Saul didn't want to stop just in Jerusalem. He wanted to go to all of the main cities to sort out these Christians. So he got letters giving him permission from the high priests to go to Damascus. And on the road to Damascus, he had some of his friends with him. Suddenly, the Lord Jesus, in a very bright light, appeared before him, and he fell off his horse to the ground. And he heard this voice said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" He said, "Who is it, Lord?" And Jesus replied, "I am the Lord Jesus, and you're persecuting me, you're persecuting my people." And everyone around was amazed because they couldn't see Jesus. They could just see how Saul was reacting, and they could hear what was going on. Well, Jesus told Saul to continue on to the town and to wait. So he left, and Saul got back up, but he couldn't see. He was blinded. And he explained to his followers that they needed to go to the town, and they were going to Judas' house, and he was to wait for 3 days. So they got on the horse, and they took him there. And he fasted and prayed for 3 days, waiting to hear from God. And he got a vision that a man called Ananias was going to come and pray for him. Now, at the same time, Ananias was given the message that he had to go to pray for Saul. And Ananias was, "Lord, no, have you not heard of this man? He's persecuting your followers. He's having us thrown into prison." And he said, "No, I have a great plan for this man. I'm going to use him to reach the Gentiles, to reach kings, to reach other nations with my message." So Ananias, very bravely, full of the Spirit of the Lord, went to go visit Saul. And when he got there and he said that the Lord Jesus had sent him to pray for him, the scales that had been on Saul's eyes just sort of fell away. And he could see again, and he went immediately. He wanted to be baptized. And after he'd been baptized and he'd prayed and he'd taken some food, God then used Saul, only this time to show the difference in him, the change that was in him. He changed his name to Paul, and he used him to spread the message all around the world. So in other weeks, we're going to find out more about what Saul's been doing since he became Paul. So take care, guys. Bye.
Thank you, Derek, for agreeing to share your life story with us today. So I'd like to start off just by asking you a question. When did you first realise that you needed and wanted God in your life?
I was 15 years old. Mm-hmm. And my nan had just died December, I think it was the 14th. And that broke my heart. Mm-hmm. And I had a Bible under my pillow. Mm-hmm. For no reason, I just believe that. If I died, I'd go to heaven. But I was so angry with God that I remember bashing the Bible off the walls and crying. Mm-hmm. And I remember looking outside, wanted desperately to believe in something mm-hmm. that was greater and bigger than myself. Mm-hmm. Not Santa Claus, because although I wanted to believe in him, mm-hmm. but something greater.
Yeah.
I was desperately believing in something higher mm-hmm. than me.
So how old were you when you made a commitment, you asked God to come into your life, you asked Jesus to forgive your sins?
Well, I was 16 years old, and I met this guy who asked if I wanted to repent. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have much of an education, and I didn't really understand what repent was and sin was, mm-hmm. till he explained that it was doing wrong. And of course I'd done wrong. He says, "God will forgive you from everything." Mm-hmm. And I remember this, I said, "Lord, I'm sorry for everything I've done wrong." Mm-hmm. And I just sat there and I thought, that's a bit boring, isn't it? I expected something to happen. Mm-hmm. And I think I had a cup of tea, and I remember running home. Mm-hmm. And I didn't feel like running, it was floating. I just floated to my house. And I said, "Mom, I became a Christian." Mm-hmm. And she didn't understand it. But after a while, she was pleased with us. And that's 40 years ago.
Wow, so a very long time. So I know we were chatting earlier, Derek, and you did share with me about the time that God actually helped you be able to understand his word in the Bible more than you ever had before. Would you share that with us?
Yes, like I said before, at school I was in a special needs class, and I looked at my Bible and I couldn't understand it. There was just lots of words, never understood it. And I remember the night I repented, I went home, I opened the Bible, and I could actually see the actual, like, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and I actually understood what it meant.
That's amazing. And can you share with us, just to finish, what difference have you found having Jesus in your life has made to you?
I've thought about it many times, and I thought, I wonder where I would be without the Lord. And to be honest, I shudder to think where I would be without God. I really do. I could be a mass murderer. I could be, I could be anything. Mm-hmm. And if it wasn't for God in my life, who has given us the peace and joy that enabled me to live a good life, because he gave us Tracy, my wife, mm-hmm. 4 wonderful lads, 5 grandchildren, and I believe, I believe that's the working of the Holy Spirit in my life, mm-hmm. where he just opened doors. I wanted to be a nurse, I went to college to be a nurse, and it didn't go that way. I went to music, and I got a job in schools. And I believe that it was the working of God in my life, opening doors, closing doors. Mm-hmm. So that's what I think.
Thank you so much for sharing with us this morning, Derek.
Majesty, and only we want to introduce you to our new subject today, and that is beyond the door. Hence, that's why we're sat in front of a door. So you'll get a visual. You know we like visuals.
We do. We like a visual.
But we welcome you to what is something we're very excited about.
Indeed.
It's the main thing we've been studying over this past 3 months, apart from the stuff that we've been obviously ministering through Soul Camp and Revelation and the Sundays, etc., is behind the scenes we've been really looking into the kingdom of God, and used a lot of the late Dr. Miles Monroe's material to give us a new understanding of what Jesus meant by the kingdom. And it's very exciting. That's why we've come up with the title Beyond the Door. Jesus said, I am the door. And I'll let Deb just take over and introduce there.
Well, that scripture that you just said, Jesus said, I am the door.
Yeah.
Which is the greatest possible door you could ever walk through, isn't it?
Amen.
And I briefly mentioned Narnia last week when I was introducing this. And if you know the story, you know the kids go to what they just think is a wardrobe. And as they get inquisitive and they press through the coats and push through, then they come out into this incredible land called Narnia, a whole other kingdom.
Yeah.
That then they go on to have great stories and exploits in Narnia.
Yeah.
And so as we were thinking about a name for this course, we came up with Beyond the Door, because obviously the best door you can come to is the door called Jesus, where you get your brand new spirit, as in 2 Corinthians 5:17.
Mm-hmm.
But what we want to explore and discover, what is behind this door? What's beyond this door?
Yeah.
What does it mean?
How vast is it?
What adventures are there?
Yeah.
What can you discover about God and his kingdom and his principles?
Yeah.
So it's going to the door, getting born again, the greatest thing you could ever do with your life. But then what's behind this door? What does it actually mean to become a kingdom citizen? And that, you know, that's where we're going with this. And it's very exciting.
So we're going beyond the door and into the kingdom. Welcome.
Woohoo!
And the first thing that I want us to grasp and pause and think about is that when the fall of man took place, Adam and Eve didn't lose a religion. They didn't have a religion to lose.
That's right.
What they lost was a kingdom.
Wow.
They lost what was intended, and which was the expansion of the kingdom of God onto the earth.
Yeah.
And we'll explain that. You know, if that's alien to your ears, we'll explain that as time goes by. Now, I've already said that Jesus said, I am the door.
Great scripture.
But having found the door, we need to examine all that is beyond the door, and the fact that it is vast and it is limitless. Now, because the kingdom of God is both in heaven, which is the invisible kingdom, and now on earth, the visible kingdom, they are one and the same. There's not a difference in terms of God's intent, in terms of the link. They are one and the same. And when we say kingdom of God and kingdom of heaven, they are synonymous.
Yeah,
so they're interchangeable. They're not. It's not a different thing. They're used for a reason, obviously, but it basically means the same thing. So when God created mankind, he was creating a colony. That's the best word to describe it. A colony on earth from his kingdom in heaven, which had always existed, of course. So he colonized the earth with creatures made in his image.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, the word kingdom, which is the Greek word basilia, is used 162 times in the New Testament.
That's amazing.
And it's mainly used by Jesus, as you'll see.
Incredible.
The word born again appears once in John chapter 3. This ought to show us something of the importance that Jesus placed on us, understanding all that is the kingdom of God and what he wants us to understand about it. Now, we all know, as evangelical Christians, you must be born again. And the saying goes, you must be born again because you must be born again. There's no other way into the kingdom.
There's no other door.
And Jesus in saying, I am the door, is showing Nicodemus in this portion of scripture in John 3 there. He's saying to him, there's no other entry point. I'm the door. And the door means you must be born again. You have to have the new creation experience to even enter this kingdom. You can't enter it through religion, be that Jewish religion or any other religion. Obviously, Nicodemus had been brought up under Judaism. So he's saying to him, there's a door. But beyond that door, he didn't tell him in that instant, but he's telling us, yes, I'm the door. Yes, you must be born again. But think about it. He says it once in entire scripture. And we know, I repeat, how important that is. But do we know how important the references to the kingdom of God are, which are vast in their appearance?
Let me just jump in.
Yeah, of course,
When you're just saying that, I think a lot of the church, generally speaking, has concentrated so much on the door, hasn't it?
Yeah.
The mass crusades and tents and door to door, and the main focus has been on getting people to the door, which we can't stress enough. God wants everyone to be in heaven. He doesn't want anyone to perish. So that is the most important thing. But then for so much of the church, we're left at the door and don't know what it means, this kingdom. What does it mean?
Well, we said under one of the Soul Camp teachings, the Great Commission, which is recorded in Matthew 28, is often quoted as going all into all the world and baptizing people in the name
the
of
gospel.
The Father, Son, and preaching the gospel and baptizing them. Then it stops, but it continues. And it says this at the end of Matthew 28, it says, teaching them, those who are converted, to obey everything that I have commanded you. Mm. Now, what we've learned in the spirit, soul, and body teaching, soul camp teaching, is the vast importance of the foundation of agape. And those were the commands Jesus is speaking about there, because there's only the three love commands that he uttered through his mouth as commands while he was on earth. Loving the Father with all of your heart, etc. Loving your neighbour as yourself, and loving one another as I have loved you. You know those scriptures, you ought to anyway, unless you're new to this. So we realize the importance of, once you are saved, that you have to be taught how to live in the kingdom.
Yeah.
But so many believers are still babies after years and years, aren't they?
Yeah.
None that we're speaking to today, by the way.
No, because you listen to this.
Yeah, you won't be a baby for long if you listen to this.
No, that's right.
But we don't think you are. Go on. Are you adding something?
I was just going to say, so beyond this door, there's a whole other way that the children of God are expected and required, I would go as far as to say that, to live in order to access...
Commanded to live. This is my command, Jesus said.
So in other words, you leave your opinions, your ideas, your thoughts, your ideals at this door. Mm. And when you step into the kingdom, we've all got responsibility to a commandment to follow those commands that Jesus said.
Yeah.
And also to swap what you think for what God thinks. Wow, if the church just did that, a lot of our problems would dissipate.
That's the way to unity, isn't it? We've been saying that for years.
Yeah.
If we're all willing to humble ourselves and swap what we think for what God thinks, the conclusion of that has got to be unity, because we get what God thinks. And what does God say? He said, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways. As high
that's
as
right.
the heavens are above the earth, that's a long way, so are my thoughts and my ways above yours. Yeah. So it behoves us to come to a place where we hear God and apply his wisdom, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And that brings the answers. Anyway, Matthew 3, verses 1 and 2 says this. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Mm. So when I was reading this afresh in terms of preparing for this, I kind of got a reminder. John the Baptist said that before Jesus. You know, I've always thought it was the start of Jesus' ministry, those words. But John the Baptist is preparing people. And he speaks of something they will have never heard.
Yeah.
They would never have heard those words.
No, that's right.
Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. What did that sound like to his first audience? It was a strange concept. And obviously people were going out to John and getting baptized and eventually baptizes Jesus as well.
Yeah.
So he had a following, and some of the disciples were already following him. Some of the 12 were actually being prepared by John the Baptist. Andrew was one of them. So
he was really preparing the way, wasn't he?
He was preparing the way. So the gospel of the kingdom we're speaking about. Matthew 24 introduces us to this concept. John the Baptist introduces us that the kingdom of heaven is near. And then it says in Matthew 24:14, and this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. Now, previously, in our thinking, we've always accepted and believed in the kingdom of God. Absolutely. We understood it at certain levels, but not in the way we're coming to understand it. Because we assume that the kingdom of God means heaven when you die, and
that's right. And,
mainly.
We see it in the future, don't we?
We see it mainly in the future. Whereas Jesus wants us to see it now. And as we look at the scriptures, we'll see that. And by and large, it's not the gospel of the kingdom that's preached,
no,
is it?
It's not.
But he said this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations. Then the end will come.
Then the end will come.
This, when the gospel of the kingdom has been preached. So it is Jesus' righteousness that gets us into the kingdom. But then, this is very important, grasp this, guys, it is our living out of that righteousness that gets us the blessing of the kingdom.
Yeah.
So entry is through his righteousness, but
we
blessing,
can't
we can't do anything. But once we're in the kingdom, we can and we should. And that's why we're commanded.
Yeah.
And it's why we do the in-depth soul camp teaching, to help us as fallen people who come to Christ to learn and gradually grow and develop into maturity. So we are pleasing God by living out kingdom principles. Amen.
Yes. I'm going to just jump in again.
Yeah.
A very great fact that I also read.
Yeah.
And John's just spurred it in Miles Monroe's book. John's just spurred it on because I hadn't seen this connection, but now I just have. When John just said that about Matthew chapter 3, when John the Baptist said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." If you jump down to verse 12 of that chapter, it says, "Now when he," talking about Jesus, "when he had heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew into Galilee."
Mm.
The next thing we hear is this in verse 17. From that time, so after John the Baptist in prison, so kind of the end of John's ministry, Jesus began to preach, saying exactly the same thing John the Baptist said.
Wow,
repent,
that's great.
For the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
That's great.
So it's like almost like, it's giving me goosebumps, John the Baptist handing the baton on to Jesus.
Yeah,
Jesus didn't say that until John the Baptist was in prison. Kind of the end of that era.
Yeah.
Jesus comes in, and the first thing he's recorded as publicly saying, according to Miles Monroe, is that repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. God, that's
fantastic,
great.
Yeah. One of the posh names used to John the Baptist is Harbinger. And it means the one who precedes, the one who brings news of what's to come, I guess. That's my interpretation of it anyway.
But fantastic.
That's exactly what you said.
Fantastic.
I've never seen that before.
No, brilliant.
Okay, so by way of introduction, we get to Matthew 6:33, which is a well-known scripture to all of us. And it has an absolutely stronger meaning when you begin to understand the kingdom. Because Jesus says this. And it's when he's talking about having your needs met and how God cares for his children, all of that stuff. And he said, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things
incredible.
Will be given to you as
it's
well.
So incredible.
Yeah, seek first.
Yeah.
So once we get entrance through the door, there's an amazing kingdom full of blessing, full of promises, also full of some persecution, you know, we understand that.
Yeah.
Also, sometimes we're called to suffer as well, you know, but not perpetually and not without reason and not without cause. You know, it's all part of the advancement of the kingdom.
Exactly.
It's the advancement of the kingdom. So he's saying, seek first the kingdom of God and I'll look after you. That's a paraphrase.
Yeah.
I'll look after every area of your life if you'll seek first the kingdom of
yes.
God. And the truth is, guys, let's be honest about this. Most of us don't seek first the kingdom of God. And we certainly don't seek his righteousness.
No.
And again, tying it into Soul Camp, at times we're not able to, and God gives us grace because he understands that we've been formed. Remember, the human being is recreated at the time of being born again. The new birth recreates us. But we still are the person that we've become.
Yeah.
And that's full of habits. It's full of sin.
Yeah.
It's full of wrong thinking. So much that Jesus had to contend with. So that's why he says, go into all the world, preach the gospel, baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and the Spirit, and teach them. Because
teach them.
It's as we grow up. Remember the ladder, if you were in on the last couple of sessions of Soul Camp, we devised a ladder, didn't we? And how you start, and agape comes into your life at the beginning of your journey, mm. on day one of your journey,
yeah.
because it's the same spirit. It's God's spirit that is agape, is in you, but you certainly don't know that or benefit from it or are able to live at its extreme demands on you without growth.
That's right.
I hope that's understood.
Yeah.
I'm saying that off the top of my head because it's so important to grasp that. We get agape on day one. We've entered the kingdom now. Now, to possess all that's in the promised land, to use the Old Testament term, which I've been reading about in Deuteronomy this morning, to now go and take the land.
Take the land.
As you go through this door, you know, metaphorically speaking, God wants you then to take the land.
Yes.
He wants you to take hold of all that he has taken hold of you.
Absolutely.
For. I'm preaching now,
yeah,
and
go,
I'm off on
go,
one.
Go.
I'll pause.
I just want to make it clear that what we're talking about here beyond the door, we're not talking about heaven.
We're talking
about the kingdom of God on earth.
Yeah.
So I've decided, just while John's been speaking there, that I'm going to watch the Chronicles of Narnia because I think we'll find some great analogies to help us with that.
Yeah.
Because
I don't
know
if I've ever seen it.
No, I watched it a long time ago,
yeah.
but I know for a fact that when the kids went through the wardrobe door, mm. it wasn't all skating on ice. They had battles to face and enemies to face when they were through there.
They faced the queen, didn't they?
Yeah.
The ice cold
queen. So we're going to watch it because I'm sure we'll get some great imagery from that.
Yeah, we will.
So beyond this door is not heaven. That's not what we're talking about. You gain heaven at the door eternally, but we're talking about what Jesus is preaching about. How many times?
162
times Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's what we're talking about.
By far his biggest subject.
By far.
Now, how about some homework? If you're able to download or get hold of the Chronicles of Narnia,
watch it.
Will you watch
it? Let's watch it together.
Don't matter if you don't. It's just a suggestion, but we will. It's a good idea. So the wonderful thing is, guys, is the kingdom's foundation. And every aspect of this kingdom that we enter, oh my goodness, is agape. The King of Kings is agape. His principles lead us to walk a walk of agape. Mm. People start to benefit from the welfare of our agape. And it's a totally different kingdom. We're in the world, but we're not of it.
Right.
The world is run by a system. You know, it doesn't mean everybody's a bad person. That's not so. But it does mean there's somebody heading up a system that is anti-God.
Yeah.
Scripture says that we are children of God and the whole world is under the control of the evil one. That's in 1 John 5:19. Underline it and gain a new understanding. So the kingdom creates a counterculture to what's going on in our world. We're in it, we're involved in it, we want to serve people in it, we want to love people, we want to reach people, we want to introduce them to the born again experience, we want to build them up in kingdom experience, but it's different. It's totally different to the world.
Totally different thinking.
And time's gone on our first session, but I want to say this, that the world is encroaching on the church and it's causing us to think about certain things. let's face it, what's happening in Parliament today is they're going, is they're talking about quickie divorces, no reason divorces.
Yeah.
They're actually saying that one partner can start the divorce proceeding without telling the other person.
Wow.
And it only takes 40 weeks and it's done. So in other words,
without
you don't have to, you
person.
Don't, yeah, and you don't have to have a reason. That's been debated. In Jesus' name, I pray that won't go through. And this is not to attack anybody who may have had a divorce. It's not the unforgivable sin. But we're talking about a world system that's gradually eroding everything that we thought was right and proper and that society has been built on. And we know that. You know, time's gone. I could list so many things, but it's a world system. God wants his kingdom to stand outside of that,
so
and to invade it with the Holy Spirit and off a foundation of agape love. By the way, just to prove that we can be posh, okay? Right, there you are. We can be as posh as the next people when we want to be. God bless you guys.
We're very excited.
Be excited. Pray for us that we get this into your hearts and that we grow together through it.
We're
Amen.
Excited to go beyond the door, and we trust you're going to come with us into great adventures. See you next time. Bye. Thank you.